And we're on the air.
So how about we start from, we'll start on my left. It's Beth. And Beth, give me, let's hear about yourself.
So my name is Beth Browning, and I live outside the Philadelphia area. I am a search engine optimization consultant and instructor, and I'm trying to immerse myself in social media as much as possible because there's so much overlap, and I'm finding it really fascinating and fun.
Cool. Bill, could you introduce yourself?
Yes, I would be called a technology gadfly. I love this stuff. I just love to play with it. And I see video, I see social media is part of the evolving mix of what makes successful recruiting and employment. And one of my missions in life, outside of making money by making placements, is to help educate other recruiters on utilizing the technology. And that's what I'm here for today.
Very interesting. There's a lot of HR people on Google Plus, I'm noticing.
It's a huge trend, and it's a big opportunity because it, if used properly, it can cut down the cost burden of interviewing global candidates. And those companies that are using it wisely and those candidates that understand how to use it have a big edge up.
Mm. Thank you very much. Lewis.
Well, hello. My name is Lewis London. I work in branding and communications. I'm a consultant, and I help some companies to build their online communications. It can be their blog, website content, or social media strategy and content. I also am involved in organizing a couple of events. One of them is the Social Media Breakfast Montreal, which is has been happening for 3 years now. And organizing some networking events because I love interacting on social media. I'm very active in a lot of platforms, but I also like interacting live with people. And that's actually how I met Ray, because we met at the Social Media Breakfast like 2 years ago or 2.5 years ago or so. And now we are actually going to be business partners because we're having a project together. So, yeah, that's basically what I do.
Project, you can say what the project is.
Oh, great. Yes, you're right. Now we can go live. Actually, we are bringing Mark Schaefer to Montreal for a content marketing workshop on July 4th, the 4th of July, which is a date easy to remember, and is when the city is in bloom. There's a lot of things happening. And especially the jazz festival in Montreal, whom a lot of people know about. And Ray, Nancy Locke, Andrew Chain, and I are organizing this to bring a Mark and do this fabulous workshop at McGill University.
Excellent. Looking forward to that. It should be lots of fun.
Yes.
Randy.
Hey, I'm Randy Bowden. I run a small virtual consulting agency out of Georgia. I guess I would consider myself as a day learner because I'm always learning. So I love the technology. As Bill said, I've been around this marketing stuff for a while, but it's ever evolving. So it's fun to be. And this platform is another new venture.
It's craziness, right? Because it's you never catch up. It's like today. I mean, I've done Hangouts on air before, but this is kind of the first time I've tried to coordinate one on a YouTube channel and a community page and an event page at the same time, juggling three different Google accounts. So you know, yeah, if learning keeps you young, I should be like 4 years old. You know? it's been great. So listen, I thought today we'd talk about the obvious, the Google Plus changes. And I just, not that I want to go through each change, you know, individually, but I'm more interested in what you think about it. And how do you think those changes are going to affect, one, people coming on Google Plus, two, people's actually enjoyment level of using Google Plus? And do you see it as a move, how do you see it in the overall strategy of Google? So I'm going to wait for a hands up on who wants to go first on that. Any of that, those aspects of that question.
Are you talking about the Google Plus platform as a whole, Ray? Is that the question?
Yeah, primarily the platform, the UI change to the format, because there's a whole bunch of changes, right? There's Google Maps and there's the whole Hangout, which is not a Hangout anymore, but actually a video voice chat. That we can discuss somewhat because obviously it's relevant to what we're doing. But I was thinking primarily in terms of the format, because that's the first thing that people saw, and that's the first thing that they reacted to quite dramatically in some cases. So let's start with the format first. What do you think?
I think I have more questions than I do suggestions, because I'm a little confused by two or three aspects of what Google's doing. I applaud it, but I'm not quite sure how it's all fitting together. Example, I no longer have a telephone in my office. I use Google Voice. Well, in the new iteration, does that mean I can continue doing that? Or do I now have to only talk to people that are in my Google circle? There's just a lot of ambiguity on what they've done. I think it's pretty neat, but I question a lot of it as far as a user.
I heard that Google Talk as such is going to be phased out. But the way that the Google Hangout now is described, is defined, it shouldn't affect that. You can still do calls. You can actually, you know, use the keypad and do calls to whoever you want. And they don't have to be, obviously, video calls. You can actually SMS and you can text and all those things on the same platform. The video is just another option on that. So when you see, and then when you see the little video camera in the corner and you press that, your circles will come up to see who you want to contact, but there's also the contacts you already have in your Google contact list.
I guess my question more is, if somebody calls me on that phone number, which I have from Google, will it still ring? Or it's not clear from the documentation.
I don't know if it rings. I just get a notification. So I've never had a ring from Google before, but that'd be kind of interesting. Is that what you get? Yes. You get a ring?
I have an assigned phone number, which I've had for years, which is a phone number of my last four letters of my name. So it's 214-444-VICK is my phone number,
okay,
which translates to 8425. And I use that extensively.
So all my literature, all my publications,
everything.
Yeah, there you go, Randy. Give him a call. we'll try this out now. Go ahead. Anyway, that's near a phone.
Right. I think Google in the new format, I mean, everybody's trying to chip away at a little market share, and Google's done a good job. I think that, you know, in comparison, everything's starting to kind of look generic. So I guess your question is, are people going to leave existing platforms that they're comfortable in because of these new whiz-bang features that Google Plus has added? I don't see a mass separation. However, as we've discussed before, I think there is a natural attrition going on some of those platforms because, frankly, people have gotten quite tired of them. But the discovery, just like Bill was saying, that this enterprise that they have built and laid out has so many components that, mm-hmm, you know, you can get very lost. Even Facebook has a tremendous amount of components that the average, I would be willing to bet that the average Facebook user never deals with. Yeah. So those of us in that use these platforms, we get in there and we start examining, and you can do this. So I kind of look at what the canvas of what Google Plus did recently as a chase after what Facebook has done. And it's good. It's been like anything else. When they make somebody, you know, changes their shirt, everybody's a little bit uncomfortable with it for first, and then they go, "Oh, I do like that shirt," you know. So that'll happen. But I also view like this format, the Hangout opportunity, kind of in its infancy of something that, you know, you can get involved with, and you don't really have to leave, you know, the comfort zone of another platform you're at. Now you have to have all the, you know, the profiles and things like that to take advantage of it. But you can pick and choose from that. You don't have to put all your eggs in one basket. However, there are some of us that are considering doing that for various reasons. So I would advise against that. I mean, I don't think that what Google is doing is going to just capture the entire market share. It's just, there's too many players out there. And my concern from a marketing standpoint, and it's a question I've wrestled with over the last several weeks, I think we've talked about it on some of your lunch hangouts, is, you know, the millennial shift. They're changing from that. They're changing to, you know, they're not They're not sitting around working on desktops. It's more mobile and how these tech companies are addressing that, and brands are addressing that too. How do you play in that?
Yeah, I think that's exactly what Google did, though. I mean, they're playing to that change, and I think the move to making Hangouts not a product in and of itself inside the Google thing, but making it actually a part of the chat thing, the SMS and the iMessenger kind of thing, plays to the millennial thing, plays to people who want a really fast and quick and efficient way to communicate with their friends, and it's a bit more social. Whereas Google Hangouts before was kind of a hybrid. It was, Hangouts on Air has always been about broadcasting, about going live, about having something you want to share to the public, because it's a public medium. Whereas Hangouts was kind of a private video chat, and that's all you could do on it. It was limited. So by taking the Hangout part and just moving it over to the video chat part is a big jump in trying to think capture that millennial market. Any feedback on that? Beth, what do you think about that?
I would agree. I think also just the fact that the interface is now more seamless across all of the devices. I just read, it was actually Mark Schaefer's blog this morning about the, some of the real challenges about trying to come up with one screen. And we have all these different devices that we interact with, but we want the same experience, or we want it to be just as easy and not have to have a learning curve every time we go to something new. So the millennials are very interesting. The other thing I think with Google Plus is that they still have a visibility problem. So I still talk to people every day that Google Plus, what's Google Plus? And they've never even heard of it. So how do you migrate people to something they've never even heard of?
Well, that's I'll just interject, because that's exactly, because Mark Schaefer did a blog post recently, and I had comment on it, because he had said that Google Plus doesn't have a business issue problem, it has a marketing problem, and you basically just repeated that. And it's true. I mean, what can Google do to solve that problem? If they even think about Google Plus at all, it's thought of as a very geekish kind of tech, crowded kind mm-hmm. of property.
Well, when people hear Google, they think of search, right? And so that's what everybody thinks of Google is search. But in a millennial's mind, I don't believe that the average millennial is going to go to Google and search how to conduct an interview. What they're going to do is they're going to go to YouTube, right? Because they've got all kind of entertainment. YouTube's becoming their search. It's video powered.
I'm going to go over to, because Bill's waving frantically down here.
I'm anxious. I'm preparing for a presentation in about 2 weeks here in Dallas for a large group of recruiters. It's called the Fordyce Forum. And in doing that, I've done a lot of research on how recruiters, which are a small segment but a vital one, utilize social media. And it's interesting. I'd like to share the numbers because it points part of the problem that you're addressing. 97% of all recruiters use LinkedIn. 91% of them have made a placement, meaning they've done business via LinkedIn. I don't look at LinkedIn as social media, nor do I think most of us. It's social networking. But it's still the big game in town for my market segment. And it's not millennials they're addressing. They're addressing more towards the boomer, the Gen X, if you will, that 40-plus mm-hmm. executive or producer or worker. Right beneath that is Facebook. Has about a 66 penetration rate, yet only 40-some percent have actually made a placement. Following that is Twitter. Twitter is 24% usage, 12% placements. Google right now is an unknown, but my guess is it's probably less than Twitter. My guess would be probably about a 15% penetration rate, and I'd say maybe a 5% doing business rate. Now, having said that, I think the huge opportunity, particularly for technology-enlightened people, is Google, because that's where they hang out. They don't hang out in Facebook, really. And sure, they use LinkedIn, and they might use Twitter. But this is the best game in town for that segment, if that's what you recruit in. I'm not an IT recruiter, but if I was, I would live and die and breathe every day Google+.
Lewis, any response to that? You're in the design space, right? In the digital web design, that kind of space. What's your feeling? Anybody that in your circle, either on Google Plus or talk about it, or?
Yes and no. I have a lot of people that are in social media on my circles. I have people who work on graphic design and they're developers. Developers, they go into a lot of technical stuff. They don't go into the practical or the user experience. What I've seen is that from other people that I have contact with on Google Plus is that these people are looking to interact, but they know that they're going to interact differently from Facebook, which is something that a lot of people still say when I mention Google Plus. It's like, oh, well, why not Facebook? So it's like, okay, they're very different. And I think that now with all these changes that Google Plus has come with, people can see the difference and can really separate the, both platforms. And that was a smart move from Google. I guess that the problem you mentioned, they have a marketing problem. Yes, they do. A lot of people can benefit from Google Plus more than Facebook. And all these tools like Hangouts, I started using it with you last year. And then sometimes we have conference calls and people go like, oh, go to Skype. And it's like, no, let's go to Hangout. And they were like, what's a Hangout? What should I do? And they don't know much about it. And they found it a little bit hard because any change is difficult. Yes. And people are reluctant to change. But once they tried it, it's like, oh, great, let's do the Hangout because I can see everyone. I can interact with him, share documents and screens. And then there's a lot more than just Skype. But I guess that, what people are saying about Google Plus and the new layout is positive. It's just for Google to grab all that and then make a hype and make communicate it better, I guess, so people can understand it.
But I think there's an issue too. I mean, you know, Bill's talking about the niche of human resources. Lewis is talking about, you know, the creative sector. You know, we're in the social sector. You know, what about the average user experience? That's who Google. I mean, you know, the Facebook. Although we're all on there, everybody's on there. But, you know, your mother might be on there, your daughter might be on there, and they just get on there to share their beach pictures and to you know, say hello to somebody or something like that. And all the opportunities that are laying there either on Facebook or Twitter and certainly on Google+, you know, are not really of importance to them. So how do you grab that average just user out there that builds up that, you know, billion people that are on Facebook?
Anybody have an answer?
I will say just to let them know how different it is and how it can be used for business. And that's what I love about it. Like, my Google Plus people that are in business mainly. Friends and pictures of cats and videos and music, all that, I keep it on Facebook. It's just more personal, my personal side. I guess it's if people know that they can use it more for business, maybe they can grab it more and then...
But haven't you, and we've talked about this, right, in previous things, you're seeing that proliferation of cats and dogs and stuff like that coming over to the platform.
So
And 6 months it was. 6 months ago it wasn't there. It might have been some gifts or something like that. I mean, you see some really bizarre stuff on there. But, you know, I wouldn't say bizarre, I would say very creative stuff. Stuff that I see stuff on G+ platform that I don't see on Facebook. So, because the professionals have really kind of been playing it, you know, charted the course and playing in the space a lot longer than the average social media participant.
I don't know what the tipping point is going to be. I don't know what's going to take from Google. And maybe, you know something, maybe it's not going to be generally adopted, you know. But yes, there are cat photos and yes, on Google
Plus. I like a cat photo.
There's all kinds of stuff.
Cats. I got a couple of them around here.
All kinds. Yes, same here. I lock mine upstairs during the Hangouts because she's a real, you know, mess. But that's good. That's the human thing, you know. And the thing with Google though is so easily managed because those people, you know who they are if you follow them for a while. So you throw them in a circle. And you know, if you want to check their stuff, then you check their stuff. It's easy. It doesn't, you know, unless you want it to, it's not in your feed, but sometimes someone throws something, you know, in there that's kind of unexpected. But that's great. I mean, that's social, right? I mean, that's networking. So I don't know if the normal person, because everybody I talk to, I don't think I have friends that who are not in social media who are on Google Plus, because they always say the same thing. Oh, nobody's there, you know? Mm. Well, nobody in your circle is there, but there's a lot of people here.
Yeah.
Oh, it's got a tremendous audience, and the up, you know, it really can just go up, right? I mean, you know, I don't anticipate it crashing. Now, some of these others now, you know, they're go back to the one. I mean, like Bill was saying, that your niche, you're concentrating on that demographic, like the 35, 40 age demographic, but. You know, from a brand standpoint, they're looking for those 18-year-olds, you know, those 18 to 35-year-olds. So how do you message to those type people? Is that an appeal? Because most of them, and we mentioned, you know, text messaging and things like that, that's how they communicate nowadays. Mm-hmm. And I don't think I don't see that as doing anything but getting more ingrained in all of our lives. I mean, that's how we're starting, just like the single screen that Mark was relating in his blog post. You want to, and the single screen is really the smartphone in your hand, right?
Yeah, whatever the screen is that you're with. You know?
But it sounds like this stuff is new. You know, literally 30 years ago, I was using ICQ, if you guys remember that or heard of that.
I remember that.
I ran a business with that virtually. I had 10 people working for me around the world, literally, and I ran it from home. And ICQ was it, and it was the whole thing. So this is not new stuff. This iteration is new. But it's not that new from the standpoint of the technology. And I think Google has an enormous window of opportunity and a huge problem of showing people that it's not that complex. It's simple, and it really has a what's in it for me payback. And for me personally, in my business, I just love it.
I would say that it is new, Bill, in the fact that just like this, what we're doing right now, in the although Ray or anybody might have a little glitch of getting it started and in the right place, but this is a fairly easy access to anyone to conduct any type of whatever, you know, business or reunion conversation or something that didn't really exist, you know, a year ago.
I'll give you an example that really hits this whole thing and encapsulates it, I think. My grandson just graduated last week in Iowa, and I was up there for his graduation. He did a project with a team of five other engineering students, which they put together and won an award with, and they did the entire project on Google Plus. When I talked to him about Skype, I said, did you use Skype? He said, oh, no. He said, we had to collaborate together and share documents and work on code and work on graphics and marketing and the whole thing. And they did it all. Well, Google should know about that kind of stuff. They should take those kinds of things and say, hey, world, look what's happening at the University of Iowa with Google Plus, because it's happening in their entire engineering department. The entire department is standardized, essentially, on Google Plus. Those things have to get out. People have to know about it. I think that's where Google has dropped the ball, is keeping the public aware of what's actually taking place.
Well, but back to what we were talking about, millennials, your grandson, whatever, there's at least three guys on this chat. I'm sure that Beth is a lot younger and Lewis is a lot younger.
And I'm a lot older, but three of us
remember having to get up and walk across the room and change the channel on the television, and we only had three channels, right?
That was my job.
We're all in that age bracket where, hey, it was get up, go change the channel, or move the antenna, whatever. But your kids that are being born today or have a few years on them, they pick up a magazine, it doesn't work because they're used to playing on an iPad. A magazine is a magazine to me, but it's a broken iPad to a kid, right? It doesn't work. I mean, that's how you got to think about it. And that change, that shift, just like Skype was around and things, I think there is a lot of play within Google in the universities. I mean, they're going after that market. So I think there is now getting the word out to you know, the masses, I don't, you know, that's just a branding. And I mean, I agree with Mark. It's a branding thing. You know, Facebook started on the university, in the university system. It kind of got that push from all those college age kids before it became anything. And then all of us guys that changed the channel years ago have taken it over. So.
Okay. Let's go back to a question I posed earlier. Do you think the format change is going to make any difference at all in adoption?
Yes, absolutely, because this format, especially the newsfeed, when you have the three column on the screen you're using, I think that's fabulous to get more information in a quick way. I found it is a lot like Pinterest. I'm used to Pinterest, and I love it because I can just scan through all the information, and for me, that's a plus. And for a lot of people, I guess it would be. Just on that note.
Okay.
Well, right. I mean, hasn't Google kind of in the overall moved into second place as the platform anyway? I mean, Google.
It is.
But what I mean, we talk about there's some discourse with the Facebook audience, and they're trying to find another platform, and maybe it's Google Plus or whatever. But there's also European countries that haven't even got Facebook yet. I mean, they're just now discovering that, or they haven't played on that spot yet. You know, so there might be an attrition going on over there, but at the same time, they're gaining some new eyeballs and some new developments.
But only 25% of Facebook users are US based. The other 70% plus are someplace else.
Yeah, but there's a lot of third world countries where they haven't even had the internet, and that's what Google is going after. I mean, they're going after these countries that do not even have the internet yet. So to answer your question, yeah, there's going to be a growth. Now, whether the reskinning of a canvas is going to make a big difference, I think yes. I think people, if their first visit's there, they're going to come. So I think it's only a positive approach. I think it goes back to the, you know, it's getting them through the front door.
Well, that's it. How do you get them through the front door? And I was thinking, because when I first saw the new format and I kind of played with it and the card thing and the auto hashtag and then flipping the card over, then you get like five related posts with that hash. I love that.
Yeah,
but I'm a kind of geeky kind of guy, you know, and I'm thinking, is that going to confuse people? I mean, a lot of people don't even know what a hashtag is. For us, you know, for anybody in the industry, being able to dig further into data from a post is amazing. And you know, I like that it doesn't auto load. You know, I like that it stays there until you actually manually either hit your L key or hit the little blue thing at the corner to upload the post, because there's many times, especially now, because it's three columns on a wide monitor, I'll skim and I'll sort of get into something, and if I'm distracted, I come back. I can still read it at my leisure, you know. So I'm in control of that, and I think that is a plus. Again, it's end of the pun, but
yeah,
I like what I've seen. I like the changes. Now it is a bit. A learning curve for me on a lot of that stuff. I mean, there's some discoveries, because I don't know that I'd ever discovered everything before they upgraded. So I think there's plenty to do. You can get lost. You can connect. I like the ability to segment into an easy way to put people in circles. I had a meeting with somebody the other day, and she was talking about communicating with her native country. She lives in the United States, communicating with her native country in her native tongue, you know, and how could she do that? Because, you know, well, you can just set up a separate circle over here that you do that, and then you set up events to that circle, and then, you know, that's how you do it. Nobody else sees it except those people that you're wanting to brand to. So that's, you know, there's some great opportunities there that once you get in there and you kind of play with it a little bit, actually the mechanics are fairly simple, you know, to do that. So I think it's getting them through the front door and going, hey, you know, because the person that I was sharing that with was a pretty savvy person working in the industry, but they had not thought of that opportunity that was there.
Mm-hmm. Wow. I mean, I'm thinking, again, it's the getting the foot in the door, getting to the platform at the very beginning, and how do you entice people to do that? I mean, I can certainly come up with a lot of reasons why you should do that. I mean, if you're sharing photos, as they do on Facebook, you can't beat the image quality and the resolution and the real estate that you have if you have a really nice resolution photo. What do you think of the new photo element, the fact that it auto enhances and it gives you highlights based on the quality of your photos? Any thoughts on that?
Well, as a graphic guy, I read on the Google Plus blog about it, and I want to dig in more into it. But yeah, for me that will be a lot of a plus. Because I can share with clients a lot of information graphically. And it's not only a photo, it's a high-res image of something, a work that I did for them, let's say. So, yeah, I like it. What I read here on the blog post is that they have an auto backup, auto highlight, auto enhance. It is great. It is better than Facebook. Facebook don't let you do that, or any other platform. Instagram let you do a little bit of enhancing before posting. But I guess that they're really getting into high-res photos with a lot of quality, and that can be a big plus for photographers, for any communication, even for oh my God, forgot the name of the infographics.
Oh yeah, because they have what's that? Not landscape, the portrait thing, where you can have a really long photo. That's very cool. Beth, do you use it?
I haven't used the photo. I mean, I've posted some photos, but I haven't really. I was in Jamaica, so I haven't really dug into all of it yet. I'm just kind of getting back into swing of things. I did take lots of photos. I posted them on Facebook, but I haven't posted them on Google Plus.
Do you not have auto upload?
No.
Okay, that's very cool.
No, I'll have to check into that. Yeah. I think one of the barriers to people migrating from particularly Facebook to Google Plus really is around a lot of the pictures, because I mean I have thousands of pictures, I think, on Facebook. I don't really care so much about the continuity, but I continue to post pictures to Facebook because that's where my friends and family are. And you know, I think people are going to want to bring their pictures with them, but be reluctant to set up 3 years worth of albums on Google Plus so that they can, you know, have all that at their fingertips. So I think that's probably one of the biggest barriers to getting people to move from Facebook to Google Plus. That's just my opinion.
I think it brings up a real point, though, and a question, Beth, because here you are. You're a technologically enlightened person who is not using this platform, using Facebook for pictures. And for my own personal self, I don't want my friends and family on this. I want business on this. Mm-hmm. To me, Google Plus is a business network, and I intend to use it for that purpose. If I want to play with my friends, my family, I'll do that on Facebook, or I might do it on Twitter. But just like on LinkedIn, I'm going to use Google in the same context. And I think in my marketplace, probably the majority of people will do the same thing.
It's interesting because I'm seeing a lot of another community that I participate in is really all people that were extreme LinkedIn advocates and are now kind of questioning some of the direction that LinkedIn is going. And they're not necessarily abandoning LinkedIn, but they are some at faster paces than others exploring and adopting and becoming real Google Plus advocates. And that's been a very interesting dynamic to watch, because there are some people, just like with Facebook, that are so diehard loyal to LinkedIn that they feel like they're cheating to even be dabbling on Google Plus. And I find that kind of amusing. But
well, there's some irony there, right?
Dynamic.
Because Bill referred to it earlier, is because LinkedIn was never seen as a social network. It's a very professional networking platform. And it's become more social. They made it, you know, it seems that they're really intent on making it more social to encourage curation and feedback and interaction and all that. And people always kind of slammed Google Plus as being a poor man's Facebook in the sense of the social networking, but Google never said it was a social network. They said it was a social layer upon the Google applications in terms of getting personal data, et cetera. But you'll never ever see something where Vic Contrata says that this is a social network. So I think what's interesting, very important to remember about Google Plus is that it's whatever you want it to be, in the sense that Bill uses it as a business strategy. I use it for both because, if I had more friends over here, I'd use it more often. But because, I mean, if you want to exchange pictures or exchange stories, it's the next best thing to your own personal blog in terms of the way it lets you format and the variety of things that you can do with it. It's just getting those friends over. And yes, I mean, I have my family and friends at Facebook, and still there's social media pros over there, and I have to sort of go over there to see them. Otherwise, I rarely do, because they'll share content on Google Plus, but it's very, again, it's shared links, so there's not a lot of dialogue, not a lot of conversation going.
That's something that I, as a social media guy, always talk about. Beth mentioned about migrating from Facebook to Google Plus. I don't think that's a question. You can keep both. You can have as long as you can handle, but also use them, like also Bill was saying, uses Google Plus for business, LinkedIn for business. Yeah, it's just like that. Like I mentioned too, like I use Facebook for my friends and for a lot of silly stuff, let's say, for more personal stuff. And then I use Google Plus for business, Twitter for business, LinkedIn for business, Instagram only for food, Pinterest for a lot of graphic stuff and recipes and stuff. But yeah, it's every platform has a sense. So yeah, I won't migrate, or I won't tell people to migrate from Facebook to Google Plus. They can use both, but then learn how to use them or use them within a spectrum, each one doing a specific thing.
Yeah, as Ms. Joel says, it's always a question of with and not instead of. Everything has a strength. I have a question for you, because there's a very high profile guy on Google Plus that I follow, and you probably do too. I won't say his name, but he says he uses ExtendaShare, which is a software or an app that lets you share your Google Plus posts across all the platforms, Twitter, Facebook, whatever. How do you feel about that?
I use it.
Who uses it? Bill, who is that?
I use it.
Okay, Bill.
And? I use it. But I use Buffer too, and I use Hootsuite and other tools.
And do you, so do you distribute the same content, your post, every time you post something on Google Plus, you send it out to all the ones?
I do. Platforms. And I actually encourage people in my market to do that, because it saves time. If anytime you're sitting, sending and sharing and writing, you're not recruiting. In my business, that's the kiss of death. So I think those tools make a lot of sense. Probably doesn't make sense for everybody, but it does in my industry.
Yeah, I won't do it. I won't post everything and copy all my platforms or other two or three platforms, because sometimes what you post on LinkedIn or what you post on Twitter can be very different. So I'm not sure. Maybe you can use the same content but then tweak it to the app, but not just copy and paste everywhere. What do you think, Ray?
I do not. I mean, like Bill said, it might work for him, but I don't do that. I keep some segmentation there. As we discussed, my LinkedIn account is my works. I don't use that as a social network. I do send my blog posts there, but my blog post deals with what my works are. So, but as far as just sharing and generating other content, no, because I want that LinkedIn account to be about me and what I'm doing. So I keep it that way. If I'm doing something, a fairly in-depth type share on Google Plus, I don't automatically put that out on Twitter and certainly don't do it on Facebook. I would say that, my shares go on outside of my blog, go on Twitter is my number one, platform that I use. And I would follow that with Google, Facebook. I do have a business page there. But I've tweaked and dialed and done some stuff, and I've really scaled that back to only my blog posts and a couple of shares a day on that platform. My personal profile on on Facebook is my personal profile. You know, it's if I'm going to somewhere and I meet Ray, I might have a photograph of that. If I'm at the beach, I might have that. It's more of a personal aspect. Now, I do share my blog post on there, but outside of that, I don't share content on that. And to be honest with you, it drives me freaking nuts to see these just, and we all have them, but these guys, one right after another, they're, you know, they generate content every 15 minutes or so, and it's just one right after another on a Facebook wall, and you can tell that it's a tweet. It's coming out of Twitter or something like that because it's got hashtags and it's broken in this and all like, and it just doesn't have that feel. It drives me nuts. So what I usually do is I just take them out of the feed. You know?
Well, but it's you know, and that's the issue. I mean, the strategy. I mean, Twitter. That's perfect for Twitter. I mean, sending that kind of information out every 5 minutes, 15 minutes, whatever, it works because the stream
goes
very fast. Sure. Mm-hmm. Doesn't work on Google Plus, so I get annoyed on Google Plus when I just see that kind of sharing going on. Now, having said that, I don't have the same people on those on other platforms, so I tend not to share the same thing. My Twitter people are a bit different. There's overlapping, and I do share my own stuff, my own blogs and stuff over across all the platforms. But there's some things that are very specific to Google Plus because I have a network on Google Plus that I know very well and know what they're interested in. And even to the point where I have to decide whether it goes on my Google Plus profile page or my Google Plus business page, I have to make that decision because I have kind of different followers on either. But on the other hand, sending a Google Plus post to other outposts kind of helps get Google Plus in people's eyes, right? It puts it out there. So if we only stay within Google Plus, people aren't going to see us. So there's that aspect as well. Yes, Bill.
I think the content, it's different if are you aggregating and sharing or are you creating? Example, it sounds to me like some of us are creating content, our blog post, and we're sending it out to LinkedIn, example. Others might be taking and aggregating content that covers a broad spectrum of your targeted audience. Well, that brings a question to me that I'll ask this group here. Do you build Google Plus for quality? In other words, a few targeted deep contacts, or do you go for quantity, broad and large? Because it's two different strategies. They can't coexist, unfortunately. You can go big and broad.
Yeah, they can. I think they can, Bill. I think that, and I'm going to just talk for me personally. Twitter is exactly that. And you know, you're aggregating and you're creating and you're using Twitter, okay? But I agree with you on we all create. And if I create content, I share it across the spectrum. I put it in every place I can. That's mine. But at the same time, on Google Plus, you know, if I read a Ray Iltz post about something that enlightens me, I can go in there and say, hey, I just read this, he brought out this point, and I can expand on that.
Yeah.
Kind of give it an endorsement because my idea, excuse me, my idea on Facebook is it's all visual. It's back to best pictures. That's what people go to Facebook for. If you put something on a Facebook wall and it says, hey, you know, blah, 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 and some hashtag, people are never going to click on that link, or the majority are not. But if it's got some kind of catch with a picture or something, they're going to sit there and view it. They're probably not going to click on that one either, but they're going to look at the picture and maybe make a comment. You know, but on Google Plus, I've tried it. You can do a roaring endorsement on Facebook. You can write, you can treat Facebook posts kind of like you can on Google Plus, and you can build a picture and you can do all that. You get very little unless it's a small audience. So
I find the interaction on a post on Google Plus compared to Facebook or LinkedIn or Twitter at about between 3 and 5 to 1. In other words, I might get one comment on Facebook for every 3 to 5 I get on Google Plus. Now, I've got about the same number, about 5,000 people on each. I've got about 20,000 on LinkedIn. I get zip from LinkedIn, maybe a couple, but I get a lot more interaction on Google+. Why that happens, I'm not quite sure, but it does.
I think it's the personality that Google+ attracts. I think it is a different personality that's attracted to finding things out, you know, to exploring things, to sharing interest as opposed to history with people. And I think if you're that kind of person who's curious, you tend to be, I think, more involved and more apt to communicate and interact with people that you don't know that well. And that's why I like Google Plus, because you do build networks and you do build friendships because of that.
Yeah,
but Ray, I think that anyone over on Facebook has those built relationships. I mean, I guess I would have said that I started, you know, several years back on the Facebook platform, and I met somebody last week that my first interaction was on Facebook with them, you know, and that's where that relationship built. You build those relationships there. It's just where, you know, my deal is what we are doing today is going to not be the same thing that we're doing probably 6 months from now.
Oh, for sure. But so my point wasn't to say that you can't do that, Randy, on Facebook. My point was that this platform attracts that kind of person more so, I think, from my experience.
Yeah, and I agree with that, and I think that that's probably one of the branding issues with maybe the bad branding issue with the general population about Google is that that's where it was. It was the creative types. It was the in-depth thinkers. It was the philosophers or whatever spent time there. Whereas Facebook was more geared towards just the general, hey, you know, is she a good-looking girl or is she a bad? Is he a bad date? I mean, that kind of stuff, you know. Mm. And there's been a shift, so to speak, and I think you're seeing some of that proliferation come over to the Google Plus platform. I mean, I see it, but and it's good. I mean, you know, it's. I think Bill said he didn't want it to grow. I welcome it. So.
I didn't say I didn't want it to grow. That's not what I said at all.
You want to keep it. You want to keep it with just your business clients.
So
you
want. I want to focus on business, but to me, the more the better. You know.
I agree with that, Bill. I agree with that. I focus on business on those, and like I said, I think my only maybe Instagram and Facebook profile are the ones that I kind of play with, you know.
Well, going back to what Bill said earlier in terms of quantity and quality, you know, for me, it's always about quality. I mean, I don't go out trying to pack up a lot of followers. The pleasure I get out of Google Plus is because of the quality of networks that I have built here. And I know that, you know, Facebook was on the whole followers friend race for a long time. And I don't know if that's changed now all that much, because I still have under 250, I think, on my Facebook profile page. And that's fine, because, you know, even of those 250, it's probably 50 people that I communicate with regularly. Same thing with on Google Plus. I mean, I have, I think, maybe 16,000 or something, but I think there's probably 200 people that I really connect with consistently. So I don't think it's all that important to follow to chase numbers as it is to chase good connections.
Absolutely, yeah.
Totally agree with that.
And it's the same thing with your content. You can post every 5 seconds. But if you don't post quality content, then it's not that valid. What you're sharing it will be garbage. But if you share one post a week, which is very good, has great content, and is meaningful for the people that follow you or interact with you, that's the key.
Yeah, that's true, Lewis. But you want to grow your audience. I mean, if you've got it embedded and you're just going to sit back and rely on the organic word of mouth from Lewis saying, hey, read Randy's blog and recommend it, and then your friend recommends, that's a slow growth. So a lot of people augment some of that with shared stories to try to keep their engagement out there. And I think most of us practice that 80-20 rule. You share, you know, 80% of other people and promote other people, and 20% of yours. I tend to try to put others always above me. Now, I don't know if that's right or not, but I tend to do that, and I get a great amount of conversation. I don't. My problem back to what you said, right? Isn't 150 the number of what the psychologist says?
Yeah.
yes. And actually have 150 relationships.
But that's the max to keep control of and keep in contact with. You know, this conversation is kind of remind. I'm a swimmer. I swim a lot. This is a swimming pool. We're all in the same pool and all using different strokes. We might get to the end of the pool the same time or different, but we're using different strokes. I think it's the same thing in using the social media. We all have a different marketplace or philosophy or focus. What works for me doesn't work for you and vice versa. It doesn't mean you're right and I'm wrong or I'm right and you're wrong. It doesn't matter.
Everybody has their own strategy. And I think the great philosopher Sly and the Family Stone said it best, you know. I mean, different strokes with different folks, you know. So I... I just want to touch a couple of things I don't want to forget, because there's a couple of things that don't work on Google Plus. Well, one in particular is the communities page. It's a bit of a mess, and I'm glad I'm not the only one, because I did some asking around the platform to see if anybody else is having problems with it, and a lot of people are. When I log into my community page, I get this like bizarre mosaic of all these communities, and it always starts with communities you may be interested in or communities you were invited to first before it gets to your community, which I always thought was kind of bizarre. But anyway, is anybody else having community page issues?
Bad.
Yeah, I think they have to work that kink out. And that into the next question is, how much of your time on Google Plus is private, meaning that you don't post public, that you actually work in communities, work inside your circles? Because that's an important question, because when people are measuring the success of Google Plus, the only data they can measure is public post. Mm-hmm. And I've been reading up to 65% perhaps of Google action is within communities or private post.
So for me, is actually, I love that Randy mentioned the 80-20. That is great. It is about that for me, interacting or using Google Plus. 80% of my time I do it privately. I research, I use it as informational, and then 20 I post. So I did what I'm thinking, but now regarding what Randy said, that's what I do. Is like 80% of my time is just for private.
When you post something original on Google Plus, is it default public? Do you usually always post public, or is it to a specific circle?
No, I do it to a specific circle. Sometimes I share a lot of public. That's when I share, it's public. But yeah, when I post something original, it goes to circles.
Anybody else?
I'd say 95% of mine is public.
Yeah, I think that's a branding issue, right? Because you have to be public. I do the same thing, about the same amount. Bill?
And the 5% comes from I was didn't pay attention and didn't put market public.
Bill, what's your?
Well, I'd like to use communities more than I do, but it's a fire hose. I just don't know how to drink out of it.
The ones that you belong to, are you mean like they're really busy or they're?
I think the problem I have, and others might have the same problem. It's so easy to join a community, mm-hmm. and then it kind of laxes and lays by the side, and you don't really focus on it. Yet there's all this content that you want to get to, so it's a matter of time, I guess.
Yeah, well, that's it.
Yeah, I kind of thought the original, it's like what we just said. You know, what works for some might not work for me, but I always kind of thought that the communities were supposed to be, you know, maybe that 150 number or 20 number or something, mm-hmm. where you got kind of a little think tank and you worked on issues, or maybe you set up a community of you're working on a project, you know. Mm-hmm. But then you get in there, you open up, you get an invite to a community, and it's got 10,000 people in it, and you go, well, why don't I just stay over here? What's unique about that? I try to avoid them. I mean, I'm in a handful, but not very much.
Yeah. What's your experience with the communities, Beth?
So when I post things, I'll answer that question first. When I post things, I almost always post public. That's what I do. Community-wise, when I first started, I joined a couple. I got invited, and I naively was really excited that I got invited to a community. So I joined it, and then I kind of got immediately overwhelmed because there was just so much information being thrown out, but not much genuine interaction. And then when I was invited to join Sherry's OpenSN community, and started participating in that private manner, and then the LinkedIn one, and then I think yours, Ray. And so all of my community activity right now is private. So it's kind of an odd mix. I post almost 100% public, but I participate in communities almost 100% private.
Well, that makes sense. And it goes back to what Randy was saying. I mean, in my mind, too, communities were supposed to be small sections of people that have something in common, either working on something together or they have something that they really want to discuss in intensively.
Yeah, and Sherry's is a good example of that. I mean, she started with that initiative, mm-hmm. and she built her community around it, and the community was kind of like participants, guests, and it's kind of grown, and she, you know, she does her show, and then she has dialogue about that or maybe a build-up before that. It works well.
Yeah. I like her community, and I think they work best. That's my experience as well, is that the smaller the communities tend to be more interactive and more they bear more fruit, you know. On the other end, on the general posting side, you don't get indexed unless you post public. So people who are in the social business community, well, even if you're not, like Bill, for yourself as well, you want to be found on Google Plus for searches, and so it's important to post publicly in that case.
So give us a grade, right? What was the from the G, from all of our feelings, you're the G plus guy. So give us a grade. What do you think of the upgrades?
Oh wow!
I know you've been digesting it over the last several days.
I still am. You know, it's like my mother's roast beef dinner. It takes a while. You know, communities. The format, I give it an A+. I love that. I love the card thing. I love the way the animations work. I love the hashtag influence. The other stuff, photos, I would give it, I'm going to give it an A. Overall, I'm not going to go into the Google Maps and the Android stuff, but just the Google Plus thing, I'm going to give it an A- because of the communities page. Well, this
I'm sure they paid attention to that.
Well, there's enough whining on the platform to
like I said, I like it. I like it, but there's always going to be that, you know. And then by the time it dies down, there'll be another one to come out. You know, so.
Well, I'm going to do a lot more of these hangouts because I really want to get this under my belt and figure out this YouTube thing. It's a shame that we didn't get everybody on that wanted to come on. And I'll work on that in the meantime. I'm not sure if I'm going to keep the Hangout on Air thing for the lunchtime thing, because the lunchtime had kind of very casual flavor. But what do you think? Did it change the dynamic of the discussion having a live broadcast as opposed to our, you know, kind of private chat?
Yeah, I couldn't drop any F-bombs. I was biting my tongue.
So I might keep the private Hangout, the video chat, and then maybe reschedule a Hangout on Air less regularly. But give me your feedback in the comments or go on the community page and we'll chat about it later. Bill, you got to go, so go ahead, and thanks for coming by.
Thanks. I enjoyed it enormously, and it was really, Randy, nice meeting you and seeing everyone else again, and yep, look forward to next time.
So thanks, everybody. I'm going to sign off, and I really appreciate this is really fun, and I think hopefully valuable to a lot of people. So take care, everybody, and